Miss Robyn. How are you doing?
I'm thinking.
Hello.
Good to get to that corner. So it's
a beautiful dress.
Oh, thank you so much.
It's a nice summer.
How do you like that?
How are y'all?
Good.
Can you get on?
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
My goodness. How are you?
We need a bigger room.
Doing well, thank you.
Good.
Are you sure? No, I don't live without a seat.
We can get more.
Are you sure?
We've got a name tag in the bench.
That means it's official. I must sit there.
You must sit there. I didn't want you sitting anywhere else.
Good idea. That's what I did. That's what I did.
I got to leave at 10 after. Oh, my God. Thank you, guys. I have to bring the books.
That's
right.
She's just doing the main mess.
So this will hit your voice now, because it's a busy day. I need a chance to get back to you. We've got enough there to cover this group. I think it'll be good. Thank you.
Can you just take one of these? These are something I put together for today, and this is great. It's going to blend in nicely to my discussion anyway. Just take one of the red books and pass it around as well. It's going to be talking about the act today, just for a few minutes. That'll get us ready. Just for the members. Yeah. Because I just make sure I have enough copies. Is all. I'll walk you through all that and get to it.
That's been worth it.
Oh, yeah, big time. Here he comes. We were just waiting on him.
Welcome.
I brought you your chair.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome, everybody. Do we want to go maybe upstairs to the large conference room?
Well, we could, but it's been noticed for here, so we probably ought to stay here.
Stay here.
Yeah, at least for this one, we may move our arrangements.
I guess I'll go ahead and start. Welcome, everybody, for coming. Has everybody who's here taken a name tag, or has anybody not taken one? So we're missing three people at this point. Okay. Well, welcome again. And the purpose of this meeting is to talk about the overlay for Highway 20 East. There is an overlay already. I'm Jim Boff, by the way, County Commissioner for District 5. There is already an overlay. It's fairly straightforward that I presented to the board, I think it was a year and a half ago. But it's basic, and I think there wasn't a whole lot of interest in that overlay at the time that I asked to have it put out, but things have changed around here, and I think people have come into the realization that, you know, maybe an overlay, the basic overlay that I have, could be beefed up or improved or modified in some way, and that's the purpose for setting up this committee. There are supposed to be seven people on the committee. We do have a situation that I know of where at least one person might have requested that somebody else be there instead. And that's okay. One of the issues with that, though, is that the names that were approved by the Board of Commissioners. And so a substitution, I think, would have to be also approved by the Board of Commissioners. That's, you know, would slow things down. So that's kind of the bad news. The good news is these are open to the public. And so if someone wants to make a substitution and can, I can bring that to the board. We can go on with the meetings. And if the board approves the substitution or the change out, that would be fine with me also. Although it may or may not add to some confusion for this board. So maybe we could talk about that after the meeting a little bit more, unless there's a dire reason to talk about it now. I hope that you either have or will take the opportunity to review some of the overlays that the county already has. Primarily, in my mind, is one called the Peachtree Parkway overlay or the 141 overlay. It's available on the website www.forsythco.com.
Giving it to them.
You're giving it to them as well. Okay. Oh, you're giving them a copy.
They have in front of them the entire overlay chapter.
Okay. Super. Many of the documents for the county that are really important, if not all, on an ongoing basis, on a planning basis, are available through one department or other, though, on www.forsythco.com. So if there's something you want to read up on, I'd ask that you look there first and see if you can find it. If not, we try to help you find any document that you need. Some of the ground rules for this, I think, will be news to people. This is an official board. Hey there, come on in. You're Robyn, are you not?
Allyssa,
my mistake.
That's okay.
Just have a seat and grab your name tag. The thing that I think may come as a bit of a surprise to you has to do with a thing called the Open Meetings Act, which is a segue. Sitting, if you don't know, with a bow tie on at the end of the table, is the county attorney, Ken Jarrard. All at the table in the tie is Tom Brown, who's the head of planning and community development for the county. They are people with massive amounts of expertise and experience. Probably, if you ask me a question, I will either ask them or defer one way or another to them, because they're the experts. I'm just the commissioner. But feel free to ask me or anybody else that you would like some questions as they come up. Let me say a couple things about the Open Meetings Act. The Open Meetings Act is a law. It says that as a committee of the board, you're not supposed to meet other than in publicized meetings. And Ken will go into much more detail about this, but it's actually a law about
what that means. It means the meetings are open to the public, the door will be open all the time. We will try to declare where the meeting is going to be and try not to deviate from that, which is why we're staying in this room tonight. And then Tom, after Ken is done, is going to talk a little bit, I think, about zoning, the UDC, and overlays, kind of in general. And unless there's some, has everybody introduced themselves to one another? Maybe that's where we should also start.
This is your comments are the first comments.
So, Keith, would you mind saying who you are?
I'm Keith Hagstette. I live at Orchards of Haversham on roughly on Knuckles Road, Georgia Highway, Georgia 20 and Knuckles. I've been there now 8 years and I'm looking forward to being part of this committee.
I'm Steve Kirby. I live in the Gates subdivision and I've been in the county since 1995. And I'm also grateful to be here.
I'm Alice Cotter and I live in Princeton Square subdivision and I've been in Forsyth County about 11 years.
Susan, will you introduce yourself?
I'm Susan Green and I will be taking notes.
Yeah, Susan's going to take care, we'll get to that a little bit later, but she's going to take care of a lot of the administrative tasks for the committee. Agendas, minutes, notes.
I'm Sharon Farrell. I supervise the planners that review all the construction and development plans that come through, that will be coming through in the overlay area.
Tom Brown, I'm the director of the planning department.
Ken Jarrard, I'm the county attorney.
I'm Tim Dineen. I live in Chattahoochee River Club, and I'm a relative newcomer to Forsyth County. I've lived here for about 2 years.
I'm Jim Myers. Live in Princeton Square. Been here about 11 years plus now, moved back from Florida, and this is home.
Well, this is Barbour. I live in Chattahoochee River Club. I've been here on and off since about 2003.
I'm Robert Hoyt. I'm on the Planning Commission for the 5th District, which is Jim Boff's district and the district that all this is in, and so I'm only here to listen, and if anybody asks me anything, I'll tell you anything I know, but I've been doing this now for almost a year and a half, and I'm still learning every day. And I live in Orchards of Haversham Grove, where Keith is.
Do you need us to go all the way around?
You too.
Who started?
I'm Pam Pullman, and I'm a planning commissioner for District 1.
I'm Kelly Whitmire, and I'm here with Forsyth County News.
I'm Kirk Winterstein. I'm with Smart Growth for Science, but I only speak for myself.
And I'm Betty Pita. I live at the Orchards of Haversham.
And?
My name is Nydia Tisdale, and this video will be available on YouTube.
Okay, Ken, if with no objections or questions immediately, if you will kind of enlighten us all about open meetings and some of the things the law says about how they can proceed in this committee.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner Boff. Let me sort of roughly following the agenda. This is, as Commissioner Boff mentioned, this is an open meeting. And I want to walk you through that. I think I handed out the red book was from Ms. Tisdale, although that is a copy of actually the law. That's the Open Meetings Act and the Open Records Act. So take that home with you and perhaps review it, but that's not what I want to talk about yet. I want to follow on your agenda. I think we've had basically, if you look under your agenda, I hope you see enumerated item number 2, discussion of the purpose of the committee. I think Commissioner Boff has already sort of covered that issue. I want to talk about sort of the operational setup of this committee. As Commissioner Boff said, you have actually been created formally by the Board of Commissioners. So you exist, I think, 1, 2, 3. We have 6 of you here. I think the committee's 7. Is that right? 7? All right. So we have, is it 7?
At the last work session, there was talk about 8. Are we at 8?
Yes, we do. We have 8 names. What we had sort of said about the 8th person, the 8th official person, either Kathleen or Robyn Hood, was that perhaps one method you could use would be to vote yourself, a chairman and a secretary, and they could be a fill-in, or the chairman might only vote to break a tie or something of that nature. That would give the 8th person a chance to participate and still sort of have the nature of seven folks. Yeah, pardon me for that.
All right, so here's the thought with respect. The first of all is this is sort of an introductory meeting. This is our first meeting this evening, and hopefully we can sort of guide you through this so your time here with this committee can be the most productive that it can be, and you all can share your vision with the commissioner and the planning commissioner for this district, and ultimately they will be presented to the Board of Commissioners, would be my expectation. So let me say, first of all, that the purpose of the procedure that I'm about to go through is not to get in your way to be intimidating. It's not a bit at all. In fact, I will have failed if you all don't feel like we can be comfortably conduct the business and have a free and spirited discussion about your vision for Highway 20. So the first thing we'll talk about is officers, and so that's sort of just a typical parliamentary device, is the election of officers. Now, this committee, I think, is scheduled to meet how many times? 7 or 8 times? So this is not going to be a standing committee, right? You all have sort of a specific purpose. You're going to come, you're going to fulfill your civic duty, meet your 7 or 8 times, make your recommendations, and then you'll be done. So sort of some of the normal formalities may not be quite as required here, because I do not want to over-procedure this for a committee that's going to meet 7 or 8 times. I will say, though, there is a benefit to a chairman or chairwoman, chairperson, being appointed simply to sort of run the meeting and even call for the vote if you're making any votes. Commissioner Boff, with respect to whether this committee has officers, I liked your idea that since we have an even number of members, it might make sense to have a chairperson that is appointed, or, I mean, candidly, at this point, if you just wanted to volunteer for it and say, I'm happy to be the chairperson. Now, whether or not you'd want to be a participating member as far as voting would be up to you. Again, I think that we have a lot of latitude. The Board of Commissioners did not give a lot of discretion on this. So if there was an interest in someone being sort of the chairperson, I'm very comfortable with that. It would make sense. That individual would then run the meeting. So basically, you'd be in charge of calling the meeting to order, sort of walking the committee through the agenda, and typically if there is a motion and second, the chairperson will call for the vote. Not a whole lot of responsibility, and candidly, given that you've got staff that are going to take care of almost all of the documentation, chairperson's not going to have that big of a role as far as the procedure, but you may want someone to run your meetings. So with that sort of background, is there any interest in doing that or having somebody serve as sort of the chairperson for this committee? Anybody have an interest in doing that? Ms. Cotter? Everybody's looking your way, no?
You guys have experience.
Anybody maybe done that for your HOA? Something you're familiar with doing?
Can we do this? Ken, maybe go into some of the particulars, and maybe towards the end of the meeting they can decide.
There you go. Be thinking about that. Be thinking about if you see some value to there actually being an officer or chairperson. Again, I'm not going to ask for a slate of officers an inch deep. There's no reason for that, but just be thinking about that. Let's go ahead and go then with that sort of in the back of your mind. Let's go to item 4, which is discussion of the Open Meetings Act. Turn in that packet, you should have a stapled packet of white pieces of paper. Turn to page 1 of that. You see page 1 at the bottom. All right, so this will be my very quick agenda. The reason that I know the commissioner wanted me here and the reason I wanted to be here is because the state law called the Open Meetings Act was changed in 2012. And one of the things that it changed in 2012 is it said this. It says that if a governing authority or an agency, which Commissioner Boff serves on an agency, the Board of Commissioners is an agency under the Act, if they create by formal action a committee, that's you. If they create a committee, that committee is subject to the state's Sunshine Law. So you are subject to this law. That did not used to be the way the law used to be written, but in 2012 it was changed. And so one of the reasons the commissioner feels so strongly that I be here is he wants to ensure that you hear from me how to comply with this law, so there's no mess-ups or mishaps with respect to complying with this law. The law has one primary objective, and that is transparency, to make sure that the deliberations and policymaking that you all will do is done out in the open. That's why the door will stay open. That's why it's going to be an open meeting. That's why the public can come. That's why it can be videotaped. All of that is the objective of transparency. So if you look at the top there, you'll see something in bold says 3A and it says meeting. That is simply an excerpt from the act. So in case you didn't take my word for it, you'll see that it says a little sub 2 there. And it's the definition of a meeting under the act. And you will see that it is a quorum of any committee created by the governing body. That's you. You're that committee. Now, is there a quorum here? I'll go ahead and skip to one of my points. A quorum in any agency is typically divided in half and add one. So with the Board of Commissioners, they have 5 members. A quorum is 3. A quorum is that number of members that is necessary for them to take official action. In your situation, if it's 7 members, and we'll act like it's 7 just for a moment, your quorum, the numbers that it would take to actually hold a meeting, would be 4. If it's actually 8, if that's our membership, and I think it may actually be 8, my position is the quorum is 5. Okay, split it down the middle, 4, add 1, 5. So I think a quorum would be 5. So let's go to open meeting highlights. Number one, all meetings, we all know now what a meeting is. A meeting is any time a quorum of you, which is 5 of you, get together and talk about the business of this committee. What is the business of this committee? Your vision for Highway 20, the Highway 20 overlay. Whenever a quorum of you assemble together to talk about that topic, you are governed by the Open Meetings Act, which means you can only do that by way of notice and agenda, which have already been provided today, and then you'll come here and assemble. Now, the good news is you don't have to worry about the notice or the agenda, because capable staff are going to be doing all that. But the reason I pointed out to you is, please make sure, this is the big takeaway with respect to the Open Meetings Act. Please make sure that until this committee is dissolved, you've done your 7 or 8 meetings and you've finally made your final recommendation and then you're sort of disbanded. Please make sure that until that time, you do not assemble as a quorum except either here or upstairs or at the other place where you've been noticed and a notice has been published to go. Does everybody understand what I'm getting at? Okay, so you have you in your life as a citizen of Forsyth County have sort of a unique element chasing you around right now, is that you are part of a duly authorized legal committee, and during that period that you are so assembled, until your period is over, your time is over, you only need to discuss this business as a quorum under notice and agenda. I hope that's not hard. It shouldn't be, because candidly, I doubt most of you all are doing stuff together as a group. But that's the takeaway.
Can I say just two things to highlight that, to make it clear? Sometimes I didn't understand this. I was on a committee several years ago. That means, if you all are at some place and you happen to go and see the fireworks or a parade or get something to eat, and 4 or 5 of you happen to show up at the same time, you can't talk about the overlay. By law, you can't, and remain legal. It also has implications for email, and phone calls, does it not?
Yeah, that's actually, you don't have my agenda.
I've heard this enough from you.
You act like you have my agenda. So, all right, so that's the Open Meetings Act. And again, I don't even have to get into closed meetings with you all, because there's not going to be any opportunity to go into executive session for this committee, which is where you can literally have a closed meeting. Every meeting that you all are at as this committee is going to be open. Fair enough. And Commissioner Boff is right. So if you're at a restaurant and you see 4 of you at the same restaurant, don't all gather around and talk about the Highway 20 overlay, all right? I don't think that's going to be your first instinct anyway. So since you are also a committee under the Act, forget about meetings just for a moment. Let's put that aside. Any paper, documents, emails, text message that you generate in the course and scope of your service on this committee is going to be considered a public record under the sort of the other side of the coin of the Georgia Transparency or Sunshine Act, which is called the Open Records Act. So if you are emailing with your fellow committee members about what went on here, just know those emails are open records. Notes you take during this meeting today, those are going to be considered public records subject to review if they are asked for under the Open Records Act. all I would ask of you, take notes, please. That's great. None of this, these rules I'm talking about, are meant to get in the way of you doing your business. Take notes, mark up the overlay, take drafts. All I would ask of you is hold on to that material, and when your term of service is up, turn it into county staff, and we'll put it in a binder somewhere and put it away. And that'll be information that can be retrieved by working with the records. Okay, everybody comfortable with that? The law is really pretty simple on this for your purposes.
But the emails exchanged, would they have to be printed and put in there? Or?
Yeah, what you can do is it's.
I don't anticipate.
If you have any, you could email them to somebody on staff, and they can then print them out for you. I don't want to put that burden on you. So if you're emailing amongst fellow committee members about the, again, it's about this topic, it's not just anything you're doing, but about this topic, maybe at the end of your service, just, you know, do a big global move and then send them to one of the county staff, and we'll take care of it after that. So, but the bottom line is the law basically says that anything you do is called in the course and scope of your service for the county is subject to being disclosed publicly. A lot of my stuff is too. All of Mr. Brown, I mean, that's just the way we work. That's what we're used to. A little new to you, you're not used to it, but so that's the takeaway. And that's, you know, if you have any questions, ask Mr. Brown. He's very familiar with the Act. Ask Commissioner Boff, he's very familiar. And if anything that comes up they don't know, they can certainly ask me, and I'll offer an opinion on it.
Okay. Can you also address, you know, supposing, you know, Steve, that you said, you know, I just thought of this, I'm going to send it out to the group an email saying that I just realized we need to do this, that, or the other thing on the overlay.
What Commissioner Boff is getting at is, you know, email, particularly when you put like everybody on the committee on a common email and send it out, and then somebody hits reply all and they respond back to you, and then somebody hits reply all to that and they respond back. There has been some discussion that looks a whole lot like a meeting, even though it's conducted in cyberspace. The Open Meetings Act, when it was modified in 2012, did in fact state specifically that electronic communications like that involving an entire committee or agency are not considered illegal meetings. But I will tell you, they still make me a little nervous when I see agencies basically discussing topics that are within your purview electronically, because who's not able to participate in that discussion? The public. They don't know. And so I just caution you to be cautious about doing mass emails to the full assembly of the committee. First of all, please don't let me scare you. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just trying to give you some practical pointers on how to make your jobs a little easier. Again, the objective here is going to be to come here, follow the act, discuss your heart outs about Highway 20 and what your vision is for it, and go home, and there'll be no problems. But what I have learned in doing this for 20 plus years is, if you learn it now, better learn it now than learn it on the other end of someone being upset that there's been a violation. That's what I'm trying to tell you now. All right, on the bottom of page one, we've kind of covered open meetings and open records, and of course, if you have any questions, even if you think of them right now, just let me know. Rules of procedure, should we adopt any? You know, we could debate and discuss whether you need to adopt a formalized rules of procedure. I think I'm recommending no at this point. If Mr. Brown or somebody from planning comes back to me and says, you know, the committee's having trouble operating, maybe we might think about adopting some. But the reality is, I feel like I'm going to overprocess this if we start adopting rules of procedure. Candidly, the principal purpose of this committee is to discuss, deliberate, and then make some recommendations. And so I don't know how many formal votes you'll be taking. My expectation, Commissioner, would be the majority of the votes they'll take will be at their formal recommendation stage toward the end, is what I would expect. Mainly what you're going to be doing is talking and pointing at maps and looking at corridors and looking at zoning colors and seeing what you think works and what doesn't work, is what I suspect. So I don't know how much procedure you need to do that. I have attached to this documentation the Planning Commission's bylaws. I think they're a pretty nice set of procedures, and if you can flip through them, if you see something that interests you, maybe bring it to Mr. Brown's attention or Commissioner Boff's attention at the next meeting. But I don't know that we need to dive too far into that right now. If you look at the bottom of page one, I mentioned there that the head of the meeting, just, and this is a very, this is like parliamentary 101, just the very, you know, very entry level. The head of the meeting should typically recognize a quorum and open the meeting. Now, today, Commissioner Boff sort of did that. He sort of came in, recognized a quorum, and then started into the presentation of the meeting. But that's what typically your chairperson would do. You will need to approve minutes. Now, you're not taking the minutes. They're being taken by Ms. Green. She's taking the minutes. Minutes are nothing other than a very general description of what is ongoing at the meeting. Most of you probably know that. What the law does provide, though, is that after this meeting today, Ms. Green will have to write up the minutes of what occurred today. She will then likely circulate those minutes to you. The next time we actually have a meeting, one of the things that's going to be on your agenda is the approval of the meeting, of the minutes from this meeting. And so at some point at your, not this meeting, your next meeting, someone will say, I'd like to make a motion to approve the minutes from the May 20th committee meeting. Second, approved. That's required. You do need to, in fact, have your minutes, and you need to go ahead and approve them. Again, not a whole lot of process, but I would want to see a motion and vote on that. Okay. Again, you're not going to be preparing them, so the burden's on off you to prepare them, but you do need to review them when she emails them to you. A real quick note on minutes, just real quick, minutes are to reflect what actually occurs after committee meeting. They're not a way of sort of revising history. So the good, the bad, the ugly, whatever transpired at the meeting, that's what the minutes should reflect. It is perfectly fair for you to raise your hand and say, Ms. Green or Mr. Brown or Mr. Gerard, that's not exactly the way I remember it before you vote. And say, can we maybe tweak the minutes a little bit? I think that's just off by a couple of words. That's fine. But the minutes should reflect exactly what occurs at your meetings. Okay. Let me see. I'm going through my list here. With respect to setting the agenda, I hope you will give us a wide berth on that. My expectation would be that staff would probably set your agendas. And agendas is simply just your plan of what you plan on speaking about. I got to tell you, folks, I don't think your agendas are going to change much from meeting to meeting. I think the reality is it's going to be look something like this: recognition of a quorum, open the meeting, approval of minutes, discussion about Highway 20, adjourn. That's what I think your minute or your agendas are pretty much going to look like. So unless you really feel like you want to go into tweaking the agenda, I think the agenda can probably be set by staff and just provided to you. Does that everybody understand what I'm getting at? I just don't see if we need to overcomplicate that. We should try and follow the agenda provided. I'm on item 4 at the top of the page. When we get to the discussion section, please let the procedure get out of the way. And on the discussion of Highway 20, just discuss. Open up the overlays that exist now. Tom's going to talk about that as far as maybe how you might want to, some issues you might want to look at and what may work and what doesn't work in the existing overlay. But there's no procedure then. That's just you having a free and spirited discussion about the overlay. And when you're done, you'll know when you're done. Everybody will stop talking, and then we can adjourn the meeting. Okay. Say in the middle of that page, you are not responsible for the legal notices. Don't worry about that. We'll make sure the legal notices are published. You're not responsible for the preparation of the agenda. We'll take care of that. The agenda summary, just another crazy rule we have, within 48 hours of any meeting that ends, any meeting covered by the Act, we have to publish a very short summary of what occurred. But you're in good luck. You don't have to prepare that either. We'll take care of that. And then, of course, we will take care of preparing and circulating the minutes. The only thing you'll need to approve every meeting is the minutes. Motions. Just real quick on motions, again, I do not believe this is going to be a motion-heavy committee. I think it's going to be a discussion and deliberation-heavy committee. When you do have to make a motion, it is the appropriate way for any agency, whether it's a committee or a board of commissioners, to take official action. It's just what you've seen on TV and what you, if you've watched a board meeting or a planning commission meeting, you know exactly what that looks like. I'd like to make a motion that this section of the Highway 20 overlay be modified to this language. You'll make your motion. And then the chairperson, if you've appointed one, will say, is there a second to that motion? And very typical in parliamentary procedure, if there's no second, that motion dies. If there is a second, then the motion is considered to be before the committee. At that point, the chairperson will say, well, is there any discussion on the motion? Hopefully, there'll be some discussion. A lot of times, there'll have been plenty of discussion leading up to the motion is the reality of it. And then there'll be a vote. And that's the typical and traditional way that a committee or agency, like the Board of Commissioners, takes official action. It's my expectation that, again, not a whole lot of motions were made. I expect you will approve the minutes by way of motion, vote every meeting. But candidly, I expect the majority of your motions will be made toward the end of your service when you're making formal recommendations. Okay. Tips for motions, I won't go through those in any great detail, but I will say this. The simpler the motion you make, the better. The simpler, the better. Try and remember that anything you say by way of a motion is going to be distilled into minutes. And sometimes I will tell you folks that things you say verbally sometimes don't translate well into something that's written down. Just be mindful of that. Oftentimes you may make a motion and you and the committee and everybody in the room understands precisely what you said and what you meant. But when it's distilled to written form and somebody who didn't know and wasn't at the meeting reads it, they'll have no clue what that motion intended. That never occurred to the Board of Commissioners, Commissioner Bob, so I want to go ahead and say that out loud.
I
understand. All right. That's really my ground rules. We have now covered in very short order a very brief synopsis of the Open Meetings Act. You know now sort of kind of generally what is allowed and what is not allowed. We've talked about open records. Again, don't you get bogged down into that. We've talked about whether you need rules of procedure. I'm recommending against it right now. And we've talked about making a motion and things of that nature, but go ahead, Commissioner.
One other thing, I'll say it the way I understand it, and you correct me if I'm wrong. Although your meetings are open to the public and anyone could walk in here at all, the public means, in this case, anybody. That doesn't mean that you, as a group, necessarily need to recognize them or hear what they have to say. You can, if you want, by some form of an agreement, but you don't have to.
Yeah, that's right. He's of course correct. I mean, you as a committee are tasked. You have official sanction, and so you have a job to do. And so, to the extent that someone comes in and is not on your committee and wants to address the committee, the decision whether to allow that is up to you collectively. And so you may see this in the Board of Commissioners at work session from time to time. People will want to address the board at the work session, not during public comment. They just want to come talk to them about some topic. And you'll see typically the chairperson, in this case, maybe Pete Amos, will say, without exception, looking to the board members to see if anybody really does not want this person to speak. And if there's nobody that provides any objection, they may recognize someone in the gallery. That's up to you. And that's sort of one of those things where you'll know it when it happens. But, you know, again, if it's going to be a crowd like this, I don't think there's going to be much involvement with people wanting to speak to you. But the Commissioner Boff is exactly correct. If you want to hear what they have to say, you are certainly free to do that. If you decide that you've heard enough or don't want to hear anything else or don't want to have that discussion at all, that's up to you as well. Again, that is kind of nice when there's a chairperson who can make that call. Somebody needs to be the spokesman for the committee, which kind of circles me back around to the discussion we left the first time, and that is there an interest in having or appointing or someone volunteering to serve as sort of the chairperson for this committee, to at least be the individual that might try to speak and try to maintain, you know, any order to these committees to be maintained.
While they're thinking about that, can I say one more thing?
Please, of course.
If you come to a meeting and there are less than five of you here, you can't have a meeting.
That's right. If there's no quorum, if there is no quorum, which would be, as Commissioner Boff correctly said, at least five. If there's only four of you and this is an eight-member committee, then you will simply need to it's not even adjourn, because adjourn suggests there was a meeting in the first place. If there's no quorum, there's no meeting, they'll just need to go home. So obviously our hope and expectation is that at least five of you come every time.
In the Army, the sergeant picked who was going to be the chairman.
Well, I'm looking. I was about to go to buy that mail at Mr. Brown. See, I've done all the talking. Now I can defer and yield the floor to the director.
Well, and I'll say, we can need one. You don't have to have one. And
that's true.
Just like Ken talked about in the bylaws before, we don't need bylaws until the day we feel like we're not making progress without them. And it's a good chance, my God, this week we're not going to need bylaws. We're not going to need bylaws. So we can start on the same path with the chairperson, just collectively as a group, making sure we follow the agenda. Susan's going to be at all the meetings, and she will. I will encourage her to speak up if no one officially calls the meeting to order. If we get into discussing item three before you take care of item two, she'll speak up and bring it to your attention that it hasn't been taken care of. So she will do her best to keep you on task, with or without a chairperson feeling like that's their obligation. And the group as a whole can contribute to that as well. So I'm comfortable with you moving forward as is. And, you know, I think there's a lot of unknown for all of you who are sure getting into this. What exactly is it going to be? How's it going to play out? So I can see it being challenging at this time to say, yeah, I want to be the chairperson. Because you might be thinking, well, after the first meeting, I'm not even sure I want to be here at all.
No, we don't want that.
I'll go into a little bit about the next item on our agenda. Just talking about the highway over 20 overlay in general. And a few things to get us started. I'm glad Commissioner Boff is here. I wasn't sure he was going to be here. So
good question.
Yeah.
Is this just east of 400? So it's
from,
not
from the city limits to county line.
Thank you. I gathered that from the people that were here, but I wasn't sure of that when I walked in the door.
Right. Passing out a document you already have. It's, in case you didn't have it with you, it's Commissioner Boff's the email he sent you inviting you to participate in this. And there's one additional page. The third page is our list of the actual committee names. So if you leave today and you think, who was that person I was sitting next to? I can't remember for sure. You got a list of the names there. It includes a few people that did not end up serving, but you'll see yes and no on the list of who's in and who's out. So you have that. You also have, I passed around my business card, the goal of the committee was to recommend, you heard from Commissioner Boff, to recommend improvements to an existing overlay, the Highway 20 overlay. And we want to have the staff available to help you with any questions you have or any requests for presentations. So we're not going to go into each meeting and really drive this from a staff-led standpoint of, here's what you're going to talk about, here's what you're going to hear. It's going to be more of a community, a grassroots type of a pretty organically developed product where, as a committee, you're sitting around, you're deciding the topics you want to talk about, talking about what concerns you, what you think would be an improvement, and you have my contact information to request any questions that you have, we'll get you answers to, or any particular product that you want presented at a future meeting. So if you say, you know, 1 week is, boy, we keep coming back to something about signs or landscaping, building materials, permitted uses, the different things you'll see in the overlay when you flip through it. You can reach out to me and say, hey, can you have someone on your staff, myself or someone else on the team, come at our next meeting and present this topic? Or it could be something more product-based, like, hey, we'd like to have a the zoning map, a blow-up of the zoning map at our next meeting on the table, that we can, 2 copies of it, 8 copies of it, whatever, that we can sit around and mark up, get some ideas. Or we'd like the most current aerial images that the county has of the corridor to get an idea of what properties are vacant versus what properties are developed, what's residential, what's commercial, you name it. So feel free to send me any of those. You can mention it to Susan as well, which will pass it on to me. Susan's going to have some cards out in the middle of the table like she does tonight. And if it's something you want to just write down while you're thinking of it and pass it to Susan, she'll get it to me the next day, and we'll get working on it. And the only thing with that I request is that you give us enough notice where I can pull it off. You know, if your meetings are on Wednesday and you call me Tuesday, I'm probably not going to be able to produce a map for you. I might not even be able to find a staff person that has the night available to come talk to you. But if you you contact me the week before your meeting, because this is set up where we're meeting a week, and then you're off a week, and then you meet a week and off a week. If you contact me that week before, I feel pretty confident I'll always be able to get you a product that you're looking for if it's something we have. So we'll do that. We'll get you what you need presentation-wise or question-wise, data-wise. You heard a lot about Susan's role with minutes, and you heard it from Ken. I'm just saying it again. You know, it's not going to be, she's not back there like a court recorder, word-word, sentence-by-sentence recording what you say. It's about things, taking action on the things that are on your agenda or things that you vote on. And I think, like you heard before, I think the voting is most likely going to come in later meetings when you've kind of narrowed this thing down and you start talking about a specific recommendation. The copies, the bound copies that are before you, are chapter 21 of our Unified Development Code. So it's one chapter of a larger book. This is the book itself. We call it, a lot of our staff and our commissioners call it the UDC. The full name is the Unified Development Code. It is our zoning and subdivision regulations for the county. So the state of Georgia empowers the county to adopt zoning, which is basically identifying different zones in our community. And each of those zones have certain allowed uses and certain performance standards. So we have on the wall, there you see our, the last one on the line is the county's official zoning map for the whole county. And it's, I think, my opinion, one of the tougher jobs our commissioners have is when people want to change those zones, file an application to come before the commissioners and say, the most common one we see, all the green up there is agricultural, and they have a quick growing community like this. They have a pretty steady stream of applications coming before them saying, well, time to get rid of the family farm, and this is, you know, Pulte wants to build a neighborhood here, or Toyota wants to build a car dealership here, or Walmart, Home Depot, a flower shop, a gas station, everything in between, you name it, will find its way through that process at some point. Overlays are one additional layer of complexity to that process. And an overlay is identifying a certain geographic area within our county and developing a unique set of rules for that. And that's what you'll see when you get a chance, and you can walk through it tonight if it's valuable, walk through the Highway 21 and talk a little about it. You'll see for the different overlays in the county, there are some that are more environmental based, and there are some that are more design and use based. Commissioner Boff mentioned the Peachtree Parkway overlay. That was one of the first ones we had. It's on Highway 141 from Johns Creek area all the way up to 400 interchange. That was one of the first ones we had. I think it was a fairly successful overlay. It has a little more, it dives a little deeper into architectural controls and things like that than the Highway 20 overlay currently does. So I think it'll be a good product to look at to kind of compare. It was something that's out there, it's being done not only in the region, but in our own county that had some success, and there's just something we could build off there and not reinvent the wheel. That's always, and I'll admit, my own staff. When we start a project at the request of the commissioners, first thing we look at is who's already doing it and doing it well, and copy one person, it's plagiarism. If you copy three, it's research. So don't be shy about doing some research. Let's see. So the overlays, like I said, has the potential to identify a new set of allowed uses for a geographic area in the community, and has the potential to identify a new set of performance standards for the community. The product of this committee, and as you flip through this, you see a lot of, you know, stuff that planners and our attorneys have spent a lot of time crafting just the right wording for. I don't, if this committee gave us that type of product, wonderful, we'll take it. My expectation is the committee is probably at the end of the day going to give more identified a list of concepts, a list of standards. And I don't think you need to feel obligated to have this final draft ready for Jim and the other commissioners to adopt type product. So don't feel that's your charge. I think you should be as specific as you can. And whenever you're talking about numbers, you know, put that number in. You know, if you're talking about there should be a larger landscape strip along the road, tell us what it is. Don't just say larger. Tell us, you know, it's roughly this. You think it should be 20. You think it should be 30 feet. But at the same time, don't feel obligated to have a all the formality and format of the code you see before you. If the Board of Commissioners take your recommendations and decide to implement them, it would require that my staff, Ken's team, go through it, put it in code format. Don't change the intent, but just get it in code format and then bring it before our elected officials and the Planning Commission for public hearings. It would be a very formal process for adoption that will happen over time. Your goal is just identifying what you'd like to see changed in the product. Let's see what else we have. As far as how to start, Ken and I were talking a little before the meeting. He had a suggestion I thought was a good one. Was just really talking about you all live in that that area. You're working, you're living, you're traveling through the community. The things you've liked, the things you've seen that you're happy with, the things you've seen that concern you. I think a discussion like that might get enough ideas flowing that you can generate a list of questions that you'd like. Maybe I can answer on the fly tonight. If not, the things we can research and come back to you with answers on. Or topics that you'd like to hear a presentation. For example, the county has a tree ordinance. The county has a sign ordinance. Those are things a lot of times that do come up when we talk about overlays. Signage in particular is a common theme in a lot of overlay districts in different communities. And if you wanted to learn more about the sign ordinance, maybe that would come out of a discussion tonight of someone saying, I'm concerned about signage or concerned about traffic. And I don't want to run through a list and you know, I want to hear the ideas from you. But between our staff and the staff in other departments, like the engineering department and the water and sewer department, I think through that kind of discussion, we could bring some ideas and what we could present to you to help you move forward. So at that point, if you're ready to just dive in to some discussion, you're welcome to it. If you still would like to hear a little more, I've talked with Sharon, who managed, you identified before, she manages our staff that review all the permits in the county. She and I could kind of walk through the Highway 20 overlay, not line by line, but maybe section by section, and just talk about in general, informally, what this is accomplishing, how it's different than what's in other sections of the code, and how she sees it come up most commonly in permits.
I think that's, that would be helpful to me.
Yes.
Again, at that point,
does anybody have any other legal questions? Because if not, I'm probably going to take my leave. But if you do have any questions that didn't get answered or you think of something later, please give the give Tom or Susan a call. If it's something they can't handle, I'll be happy to handle it for you. Good luck to you. Best of luck. And I know y'all will be successful. Right? See you.
Thanks, Ken.
Thank you.
Your briefcase, sir?
Okay.
Briefcase. Oh, that's got a bomb in it. So I'm not
Evacuate.
That's it.
Yeah.
Thank you all very much.
Because I couldn't figure out.
Tom, actually,
yes.
Could I
please
see if people might be interested in this? Without before Tom starts with what it is that he wants to do. If you have an idea about what it is that you already think needs to be done with Highway 20, maybe if you went around the room and maybe nobody has any preconceived notions or things that are, you know, have kind of driven you to want to be on this committee, if we could go around the room, Tom can hear them and maybe say that's exactly what would be in an overlay or that's already handled by the UDC or I never thought about anything like that before. I don't know what it is you might respond to, but just kind of get everybody's
anybody's idea of what's missing or what should be improved on Highway 20, maybe your top two things if you have two things. Please, go ahead.
Okay. I guess when you ask me top two things, there's number one that jumps out, and that's car dealerships, and are we going to have Highway 20 turn into what in my mind is like Roswell Road down in Sandy Springs, where it's almost nothing but car dealerships. So that would be a concern of mine. And
do you want that?
I don't want that.
You don't want lots of car dealerships?
Yeah.
Okay, so
I'm sorry, I should
stand kind of your there, your approach is there a way to limit?
Yes, and I didn't know if that's covered in the overlay or not now, because I would definitely hope that
obviously it's not prohibiting them, right? Because we're seeing a lot
right,
of them.
Right, exactly.
It's not, and that's the answer. It's not prohibiting them today. There are some, as we walk through, you'll see there are some standards specifically called out for automobile-focused establishments. But it's not today gone so far as to prohibit any type of use. And the answer is yes, an overlay could do that. An overlay could say certain uses aren't going to be allowed in that corridor, and or could place additional standards saying, rather than saying, you can't come here, they might say, well, you can come, that certain use could come to this corridor, but if you do, you're going to have to do X, Y, and Z. And there's I've seen communities tackle that both ways. Okay. So, okay, we got that noted.
I'm sorry.
Did you want to say something?
No.
All right. I guess the main reason that I'm here is the most recent proposal to put a Toyota dealership in what I deem my backyard. And but I've been in, you know, been in the county 20 years. I was on the Homeowners Association board when Cruise Crossing came in and North American Properties, and they did a nice job of presenting what they wanted to do, and they allowed feedback for us. And I'm not opposed to development, but I'm with Keith that, you know, how many car dealerships do we need? It's typically been a single family development around in the area, and all of a sudden significant commercial development is desiring to come in, and a lot of it's been allowed. And then there's a fine line between what's county responsibility and what's city responsibility. Commissioner Boff and I have talked about some of the signage that are in the city limits, and so there are different things there, and that's why I'm here. Protect the quality of life if I can.
Okay. Signs are I said before, this county has a sign ordinance, and our ordinance is significantly different than the city of Cumming's sign ordinance. And you'll see that with new developments in our community. We don't allow the pole type signs, we don't allow billboards anymore. We have some restrictions on electronic signs, and the city in general is a little more open to conveying commercial speech, and they're a little more flexible on that. And it's a trade-off. You know, business owners will have a long line of business owners at my door wanting more, bigger, brighter signs. So it would help their business, it would raise taxes and everything else. And it's, there's different opinions on that topic for sure.
Well, I'm affected every day by Georgia 20 as we all leave our homes. Everyone sitting here, you leave at a certain time of day because of the headache of getting out on Georgia 20, especially if you're going from where I live over into Gwinnett County. You just don't do it. So what I would like to see is controlled growth and more responsible growth for this county.
Okay.
Especially as it comes to, you know, so we're just talking about Highway 20 here. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want it to turn into something like the Mall of Georgia, where it's just, it takes you 30 minutes to go 2 miles, you know, Saturday afternoon, Sunday afternoon, whatever it may be, because there's so much growth in that one concentrated area.
Off the top of my head, I'm trying to think, an overlay theme that might be close to that. And one is, you'll see in some overlays, are higher standards for interparcel access. We could lock down 500 feet each side of Highway 20, and you know, Jim could open up the county coffers and buy it all out, turn into parkland. But as the county continues to grow, and Gwinnett County continues to grow, we're still going to see an increase in traffic.
Correct. No,
so there's going to be a challenge if we look at growth alone. But one small step in that direction that we'll see sometimes in overlay are higher standards for interparcel access, so that there's the opportunity that when you're at the Dunkin' Donuts and your next stop is the car dealership to get your oil change or whatever, you can, and they're only two parcels apart, you can get there through the parking lot and not get back out on that main road and clog it up. It's a small step in that direction, but it's one, and I'll be thinking of anything else to throw out there as well as that. And then also, Drew, just understand what you're saying is, if you have future uses that are attracting people from outside the corridor, and car dealerships will want to do that, attracting people from outside the corridor, then you're adding to the already heavy traffic base. Mm-hmm.
Could I add one thing too? It's just the creep down the side roads, like, you know, the North American Properties, it's down, Publix has gone down Samples Road, the car dealership's going to go down the road that you live off of there, and it's not just on 20, it's actually moving in further inland than that. Sorry.
That, and we'll see sometimes our commissioners will often try to address that through zoning conditions and putting the buffering on the back of those properties that front Highway 20, having the proper transition as you move away. And that's another thing our overlay could talk about is putting the performance standards in place to transition away. We realize there's going to be a good amount of intensity right on Highway 20. It's a major state road. But how do we feather it as we move away so that you can really draw that line and not have it, as you said, creep down those side roads? Okay.
Now, Tom, what was that you said about parklands up and down Highway 20?
You want to, don't want to say that.
You're in charge.
Yeah,
chairman.
I love
you. Yeah. Well,
I think that sounds like a great idea.
You comes with the price. There's all kinds of great ideas when it comes time to pay for them. They're challenges.
I agree with all the other speakers. I mean, I wasn't thrilled about, you know, the Toyota. I've heard the arguments back and forth, but to me it seems inappropriate for the area. And you know, I mean, if yes, somebody could wave a magic wand and it'd be parkland up and down Highway 20, that'd be great by me. But I'm a realist and I understand that, you know, as a major thoroughfare, it's most likely to be developed. My concern, what I really would like to see, is that it be developed appropriately and, you know, maintaining the standards and the high quality of standards that I believe that the area reflects. I mean, it's a beautiful area. It's so lovely to drive up and down across the Chattahoochee River, and I would just like to see that be preserved as much as possible and not
quality,
turn into Mama Georgia.
Yeah. A desire for quality development is a theme in most of our overlays, some more than others. And as you flip through that chapter, you'll see in some overlays, like the Peachtree Parkway one, there's a lot of focus on upgraded landscaping, upgraded building materials, and prohibiting certain colors. You know, keeping that guy wants to paint his building neon green, you know, saying no to that from the code standpoint. We have other ones that are more looking at quality through trying to identify a certain theme, like an equestrian theme, and there's overlays that require a four-board equestrian-style fence. There's more than one. You see, there's one at the Publix at Castleberry and Bethelview. Mm-hmm. There's only two of those corners developed so far, but that's an overlay. The Publix and the CVS that are there, they have the equestrian fencing out by the road, and they have a similar stone face on their buildings and color. Mm-hmm. So it's identifying a few things that seem like they would apply and work for any business, and putting them in place. So we have a lot of examples of that already. You'll be able to look through and maybe find some that you like.
Jim? I moved here about 11 years ago, and I knew the road was going to develop because there was, but from basically from Ronald Reagan Boulevard east, the speed limit was 55 miles an hour. You could go a long way before you saw another traffic light or had to stop. And Nichols Road was a real route. But when they said they were going to do it and they were going to build it, I knew that there was going to be a lot more traffic coming through because it's a major artery now. And that's going to bring all the people that want to access for business to that major artery. And I think Alice said it right. I wrote it down when she said, responsible growth. Yeah, we got to do it, but be responsible about it. And there's a place for everything. What's coming to mind is a road that probably most of us have been on or seen, and it's down in where Holcomb Bridge turns into Highway 92, really, and goes toward Canton down there. Between Highway 9 and Cobb County, they've done a really good job down there. They've allowed some growth at intersections with some gas stations and some Publix or Home Depot, something like that. But along the road, there are no car dealers or anything like that. And what they did allow, that was put in really, really nice. We've got a major artery that's already been built that's, I think, some car dealers, I know Cadillac is fixing to look into coming down here at near Costco on Ronald Reagan Boulevard, I believe, somewhere in that area. That would be perfect for those kind of businesses. They've got good access to 400. People can get to them. We just need to figure out what would be a good fit on 20 and, you know, bring some money into the tax coffers, but be a good fit for the neighborhood that's already there and not hurt the values of the bedroom communities that live there already, as well as the traffic getting in and out and making that impossible. When we talked about the Toyota store, they kept talking about the hours and they were going to do this and that. What they never talked about that is going to be a problem, and we're going to experience it where we live, is the people that are going to bring those cars in for service, they're going to have to come in the morning and come down Echoes Road to make that left turn in there. And, you know, you take your car in for service in the morning, you're going to do it at the same time people are coming out and trying to go to work. And that's going to be a problem, and that just wasn't discussed. We're going to have to butt heads getting out of there with the people that are trying to get in and make a left turn.
Access points for businesses, traffic.
Yeah, they just
responsible growth.
Stuff like that with that much traffic. It just, a better fit, I think, would be someplace like Ronald Reagan Boulevard, where it hasn't been developed yet. There's a lot of that out there. Mm-hmm. And if you build it there, they'll come. Yeah, that right there, that could turn in.
Pardon?
Ronald Reagan? No. There are parts of the city. That corridor.
Costco's in the city.
Yeah.
Costco is.
That's the city of Cumming.
And you were talking about signs. I was thinking of something, to me, it's kind of humorous. And I don't know. Who's responsible for the signs along 400?
The billboards?
Between 13 and 14.
Right. Who's responsible? Well, private companies own them.
Right, but as far as approving them.
Most of them are in the county.
Approving them.
Approving them? Well, the ones you see, none of them have been approved in a long time. They've all been there.
Well, there is one that's relatively new, and we all see it when we come north, and it's that new electronic sign. And I crack up. The message is so gross. Fred's Beds. That just kind of looks like used up bed bugs beds, you know, or something like that. I don't know who would even buy.
You're allowed today in the county to convert a traditional static billboard, or a what they call the tri-vision, the old kind of like blinds that flipped.
Yeah,
you can convert those over to digital if you follow certain requirements. So that was I don't know the exact sign you're talking about. I think it's maybe the one near Majors Road,
mean,
it's coming north from 13.
The low one?
Yes.
Okay, I don't know what I'm talking about. So that had been there for a while, but it did in the last, I don't know, last few years, it did convert over to digital.
Yeah.
But you can't, that type of sign, traditional billboard, you know, a 10 and a half feet by 36 feet wide on a pole, 60 to 150 feet in there. We don't permit those anymore in the county. The last time those got built in the county was about 10 years ago when our sign ordinance got challenged in court, and we came out on the losing end of the challenge. And the sign company had submitted multiple applications at the same time. The ordinance got thrown out, which is a strategy they use, and was successful back then. We've changed our ordinance since then, and we haven't been challenged since. We've been successfully keeping those types of signs out of the community. But they are allowed to convert over to digital.
Yeah, which means that there aren't not going to be, unless there's a court challenge, any new signs. That's not a new sign in the sense that it's an additional sign. It's a modification to an existing sign.
That's right, for those billboards.
So, and also, you should know the county, and this is a legal question, but the county has, our sign ordinance addresses in no way the content of the sign.
That's true. That came about the last time we had that court case. It wasn't the primary reason. Actually, the primary reason was because we had a variance process in our ordinance. And a variance process is difficult to deal with and justify it as it relates to free speech. But we have a content-neutral ordinance. So if, we talk a lot about car dealerships. If there was a car dealership that came in and they qualified for a new sign on the front of their building or out by the road, we know from just the market, they typically want their name on that sign. But if they wanted to put, McDonald's is having 99-cent Whoppers today, they could enter into a contract and lease out their sign if they wanted to. So if we get into a lot of talk about signs in the future, which is a good possibility, I'll probably be the one to come speak to you on that topic. Content neutrality is something we'll talk about. So we always have to keep in the back of our mind as we talk about signs that we never regulate the content, because as a government we're trying our best to steer clear of First Amendment issues. And the only times we get into content if it was something obscene. Any thoughts, any ideas, or has it all been said?
I agree with what everyone has said. For me, the only thing I guess I'd like to add is what I'd like to see along 20, in addition to controlled growth, is the look and feel of it to change somewhat. Yes, it's a more of a industrial, at this point it looks more industrial, more commercial, than if you go to parts of Peachtree Parkway, if you go down to Peachtree Corners. There are other parts where you can look at, even if you look outside the county, if you go down to Peachtree Corners and you see cute little, it's very industrial if you go down Peachtree Parkway, or Peachtree Industrial Boulevard, but that's that area around Berkeley Lake is still, you have a lot of industry, but it's tucked back, so you have to find it. So maybe that is part of pushing things back or putting plants or trees high up or changing the architecture of how buildings are designed. Maybe they all have to be the same color or however you have to do it, but things like that might help, at least so we're not faced with glaring Scott's Auto Trader or whatever is on the road that is screaming industrial, 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 commercial, commercial, commercial. Mm-hmm. As we're driving down to get to our communities that were once worth more, that will be worth less as more industrialized or commercial properties come in along 20.
I think the reference to the feel
is a topic, won't be surprised if you come back to a lot in these discussions, because that's something, you know, the use is one thing, but you'll see as you move through, just in the north side of Atlanta, as you move through Dublin, Sandy Springs, Roswell, Milton, Alpharetta, Cumming, you name it, you'll see similar uses, but how they're designed differently, mm-hmm. and how that changes the entire feel and the experience of being on that street. And you know, some of the easiest examples are, you can take something like a CVS, and you see a very, you know, on one end of the spectrum, you have the rectangular lot, the box-shaped buildings on the back, a plain Jane parking lots in front, and a pole sign. Good or bad, that's different than what you also see in different communities where you have the street, the building pulled up closer to the street, get a little closer to the street, maybe only one or two rows of parking between the building and the street, the rest on the sides of the buildings to bring it a little closer, give it a little more of a pedestrian feel rather than an Autobahn feel of just burn through here as fast as you can when there's not traffic, and when there is traffic, sit there and hopefully something's good on the radio. But part of this group could potentially can be, are there certain, I don't think it would be that you're looking for a pedestrian feel on this whole corridor, one end to the other, but are there certain nodes, are there certain intersections that this group sees as having a potential to be more one of those places you identify with and you feel is a little more of a destination, not just a another roadside attraction, another place to drive by. So feel can definitely be part of it, and I think feel is a mix of building layout, landscaping, signage, building materials, colors. And you'll see some overlays. We don't have, I don't think Peace Street Parkway even gets into it, but you know, some communities will have, so far as where they're really working on that feel type aspect, they'll have rules and regulations about your walls that face the main street. You need a certain percentage of windows and doors. Your facade can only be so long, you know, a blank brick wall can only be so long before you put a break in it and set it back a little and change that plane that it's on, or at a minimum have some breaks in it through windows, or change of materials. The long wall, the length of the football field, contributes more to that industrial look that you're talking about. And those are all things that are a good fit for an overlay. The challenging part is deciding exactly what you want and how to get it, but there's a lot of potential there.
Can I ask a question? Sure. The overlay district applies to areas from 400 southeast to the Chattahoochee, is that correct?
With the exception of the city of Cumming.
Okay.
Right.
So can different standards be applied to different areas along that corridor? I mean, what may be appropriate in one area may be less appropriate in another area of that same overlay district.
Good. Yes. Yeah.
Good question.
One of the things was,
Keith, would you have something you'd like to say about the overlay or what you'd like to see?
Not at this point.
Okay.
Thank you.
One of the things I think we have to recognize, and one of you mentioned it, but I can't remember who, is being realistic. We have to be realistic. This is commercial property. We're talking about all along Highway 20. The best thing we can do is to make it as palatable as possible. And you guys haven't met Betty yet, but you'll hear a lot from her because she has a lot of knowledge on this. But she made me aware that just the subtleties of going from a flat industrial type of roof to hipped or gabled type of presentations.
Absolutely.
Makes a big, big difference. And mm-hmm. I think that's, as you said, the feel of things, the feel of what you get when you drive through an area.
I don't know if Alpharetta is requiring it or if I just see a lot of it down that way, but even gas station, the canopy is over gas stations. You see, rather than just the 2 foot wide metal band, some communities have a little bit, just the start of a parapet roof, mm-hmm. and it gives the sense of
looks a little more like a structure, looks a little more like a home, and that's a big part of it. In the Peachtree Parkway overlay, you'll see some examples of starting to get into that and talking about how landscaping needs to be integrated into the building, how the facade needs to be broken up. I think there's even things about starting to get into some roof pitch and parapet type requirements of that.
Yeah, it's a 30% change. And sitting here listening, what I should have included, and I certainly will send to you, is we have also in another chapter, it's not considered an overlay, but it really is a type of overlay, is our big box ordinance. So anything larger than 50,000 square feet. Now, it's only applicable to retail, but certainly, you know, some of that language could be pulled from there. And that's real specific. It's basically for the Walmarts coming in, and where you do get the break, and the break with the roof lines, right. The break so far back, a bigger buffer in the front. And also one of the things I found interesting when I first came to work here, the industrial code, if you're in an industrial zone and you're building a warehouse, which Forsyth is blessed, has some beautiful industrial parks, the landscape strip out front, it was one of our largest landscape strips. It's 25 feet, and we don't get a lot of applications for variances to that. So a lot of the parks, when you come in, and the older parks, now that the trees have matured, some of those industrial parks look better than most of our retail stores. So even just a little greener up front, like you said, back tucked, certainly couldn't, you know, say you have to be a quarter mile back. But it's amazing what going from 15 to 25 feet can do, also for tree growth. Mm-hmm. And one of our staff members, our arborist, who is also our landscaper, you know, he can speak to that if you wanted to come one night. And he has one of our better checklists in your backup, because he has all his overlays. So you can kind of flip back and forth quickly and not go through all of this if you don't have time. But you can see where one is 15% and 40% evergreen, and one is 30%. You know, so you can kind of hop around in the text, and then on your own, you know, if you drive through the areas of the overlays. We haven't had as much commercial development on the 20 and the others as we have in Peachtree Parkway, and that is different. A lot of that design is based on the collections, the avenues.
Right.
But you can actually see it then. Oh, that's 15 feet, and then take a ride somewhere else. Okay, now I visualize the 25 feet.
An example, I think what we're all talking about is the way they've done the businesses that have popped up in Windermere along that parkway there. They look like they're part of the community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it sometimes it's hard to, you know, get the language right, but it can be done. It certainly can.
I'm really glad that they're having this look at the overlay. The original one was done, and it had some standards for fuel stations and standards for car dealers, not a limit on the number. But I learned when we were at the public participation meetings on the Toyota application, somebody came from the state DOT and explained what it is they're doing to the road. And the road from the Publix to the river, you know, it's being torn up now. It's going to be being created. So it's kind of a blank canvas that this process can help create a palette that people who want to build or develop there can choose from. So, you know, over by Chattahoochee River Club, they had a nice entrance and everything else. And I drove by there the other day, and there was nothing.
Terrible.
You know, and they told us that it'll be about November of 16 before they finish the intersection at Eccles Road. So that means that, you know, once that's finished, people then will be able to start figuring out what they want to do with the land. But now's the time to try to come up with the standards, and not just all commercial. You know, there may be some areas in there that would be nice for residential communities or senior residential communities or things like that. There are still some stretches of two-lane road that don't have anything on them now, and this is your chance to kind of not only create something that looks nice as you drive along the road, But the interface between that strip, right now the overlay is 250 feet from the center line. The interface between that and the neighborhoods behind them is a really important part of what you're going to be looking at. And an example is, I understand that the application for a car dealer right up against the gates was withdrawn.
That was actually a Nissan dealership.
Yeah, Nissan. Yeah, that was recently withdrawn. And there was neighborhood input into that from the public participation meetings. And so,
down there by CRC?
No.
No, this is
by the gates.
No, near the fire station.
Right near Samples. Oh, Taco Bell.
Oh, man.
So you can create choices for people, whether it's residential or a nice development, as well as anything commercial.
Having attended those meetings for the Toyota dealership, I was astounded at the amount of revenue that they proposed to generate. I think, if I'm not mistaken, it was $100 million a year in revenue. Is that correct?
It sounded like a big number. I don't know.
It was a massive number. And obviously, we want that revenue in Forsyth County as opposed to going to another county. It just, the way we, as Allyssa said, the way we go about dressing it up and presenting it. But one of the things, and I may be getting way too down into the weeds, but I'm going to bring it up anyway, is that when the, and I think it was Q Automotive, was approved, they were allowed to have 35% of their product displayed to the public. Well, damn if they didn't come out later and request an amendment to that and wanted 75% of the product. So while we might have the best of intentions and how we want it to feel as you drive through it, they always go back and want to modify their initial request, which was approved.
It was approved?
75? No, the 30% was approved.
Oh, yeah.
And, however, they went back for the modification for the 75%.
How did that go?
I can't remember.
It was denied.
Was it denied? Okay, thank you.
Yeah, they can always go back and ask to change zoning conditions.
Yes.
But it does require legal ad, one of those yellow signs out front in a public hearing. So it's not just a, you have an opportunity.
And no, it's not a rubber stamp, but yeah. I didn't mean to imply that.
No, I mean, I know everyone at the table probably has different levels of experience. I know you've been to a few meetings.
Yeah.
There are some new faces in the room, and I don't know if they've been there or not. So there is a public hearing associated with it.
Yeah.
But that's both good and bad news, is that you got to stay on top of it. You got to come, you got to carve our night out of your schedule to come say why you don't think that's appropriate. And it wouldn't be surprising if there's a few applicants, that's been their strategy, is let's take this and we'll fight, round two, a couple months down the road.
Right.
See if we get people just worn out. Okay, well, what's the desire? We can walk you through what's in the overlay now, but also, like, before nine hits, for you to think some about what you'd like to accomplish at your next meeting, as far as if there's something, if you want a meeting that's just the committee getting a chance to bounce some ideas around, that's fine. If you want your opportunity as a quorum to discuss what you might want from staff, your one opportunity to do that is at this meeting. So if there's something you want,
And I should say, at least at this point, it's not my intention to be at any more of the meetings unless I'm requested to be here. Just want to let you know that.
Yeah, and I'm gonna have, Susan's gonna be here always to take minutes. Other staff members are gonna be here if there's a request for a product or a presentation. So that's again why 4 or 9 o'clock hits would be valuable to, if you want something like that, talk about it and square it away and make sure we get you what you need to stay productive.
Can we get some printed maps of in color of what is and what's projected?
We can get you printed maps. Let's talk more about what you want on
current zoning, right?
current zone.
Right. Zoning map with a corridor. Okay, we'll do that. The when you say projected, my best guess is probably the closest fit I can think of is the
well, there used to be a map.
Future development.
One of these big ones, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so that's our, that's a map that's one page of our county's comprehensive plan. It identifies different character areas, and in those areas it identifies uses that are appropriate. It identifies kind of the general theme of the area. And both the Planning Commission and the Board of Commissioners use that entire document with a lot of focus on the map, but the entire document as a tool to evaluate land use to the applications that come before them. So on one of those, you know, we talked a lot tonight about car dealerships. I have my sense that's going to be a continued theme.
You betcha.
They have one of those, they have a rezoning application in front of them for a car dealership that wants CBD. They turn to that document and say, well, all right, the property's in the yellow corridor up there, and that's a development corridor. You can flip through and see, oh, in a development corridor, primary land uses are identified as being commercial, and CBD is identified as being in an appropriate zoning category. So we'll get you that map.
Sure.
Zoning map, future development map, a map of aerial images is what I think you might find.
Yes.
Okay.
I saw something. I was looking on the website, and there was that kind of interactive map where you could have the different layers.
Yeah, GIS viewer.
Yeah. And something that intrigued me was there's a historical sites layer. You could have that. And I noticed that there were several historical sites on Highway 20. I'd like to know what they are.
Did you have difficulty, though, with the resolution of trying to see?
Yeah.
You have to zoom in so far that you really can't see anything.
Because when you go in and zoom out, it starts getting a little flaky. But, you know, I guess I'm out of there.
I won't be here next meeting, but I will be after that. But I'd like to know the process of, right, because I understand landowners' rights, and then how can they take one parcel that's zoned a certain way and then move it through the process? If, you know, just a brief review of how that works.
The process of developing?
Yeah.
Going from the farm to the car dealership.
We're going to find out how the sausage is made.
Absolutely.
And I think what we were talking about today, car dealership shoved in between other dissimilar businesses or whatever in neighborhoods, as opposed to grouping them together.
Well, I was in the business. I did 20 years in the car business. And if you've got a corridor where traffic is going, if you put up a successful dealership, it's almost inevitable. Their business, competition begets business.
Oh, absolutely.
And they love it. They want to be next to all those other ones.
Yeah, but I have to say that that has up till recently not been the case here in this county. There's a Mercedes dealership in the South End. There's the Andean Chevrolet has been there forever. There's Troncali, a good deal down the way. So the fact that they've been there a long time, to me, I take as an indication of success. And the fact that they had until recently started clustering together, I don't know what the explanation for that is.
Well, it's the new road and the people that it's bringing, the traffic that's going to become 20. What are the numbers on the traffic on 20? Just in the, how has it increased just in the last 10 years? And you know what it's going to do once it's wide open. That's why they want to be there.
Probably at that DOT presentation.
Mm-hmm. Steve, can you tell me more about you talked, and I want to make sure I deliver or bring someone that can deliver what you want. Talk a little about the process for uses going next to each other.
Right now, and the area that I'm talking about is between Samples and the entrance to the Gate subdivision. You know, we have on the corner there's QT, then there's McDonald's, then there's AutoZone or something.
AutoZone.
Yeah, and then the Taco Bell. And then next thing you know, you're talking about putting a car dealership, which the depth of that is significantly greater than what you have with the smaller businesses there, the service type businesses. versus, in my estimation, that's a big box retailer. And my family been in the car business 50 plus years, so.
You understand.
My dad would roll over in his grave, but.
So what we have today to regulate that, if anything? Is that the question?
Well, there are, and, you know, there's a church, and there's the fire station, and then all of a sudden, you're going to shove a big box right in the middle of what is a basically a limited service type business.
All right. So I think it's really probably the closest thing I'm thinking right now is a maybe more in-depth discussion of that map and how rezoning applications are evaluated and reviewed.
Okay, exactly. And,
But the first step is that, at least in theory, and Tom, please disagree with me, if I believe I can do something with a piece of property that I want to buy, I can ask that it be zoned as an airport. I can ask that it be zoned as a uranium mine, right? Because I'm going to buy the land or I already own it. I have the right to request that. I don't think that's really a question, but maybe it is. Yours is, once the request comes in, why would you say, I'm pretty sure a uranium mine won't go there? Or, you know, and I think what you're saying is that in your mind up till recently, you were pretty sure a car dealership wouldn't go there.
Exactly.
And why is your thought different than what the reality looked like it was coming down the pike as? Why aren't you protected, I guess maybe is the word, or why can't your expectations be fulfilled in the zoning laws that we have, that would have been so obvious it couldn't happen that no reasonable person would have requested it?
Fair enough. I mean, once again, it's been a single family area, added some multifamily with some of the 55 and older stuff. And then everything else is light retail stuff that closes at 8 o'clock at night, 9 o'clock at night, and all of a sudden you got car deliveries that could go on at any given time. Service departments that open at 7 o'clock in the morning, and I appreciate that when I take my car in, but I don't want to drive across the creek to do that.
Okay, so what I hear is once submitted, how the county is reviewing and evaluating zoning application, what kind of things go into the mix?
Correct.
Okay. That's a good question. Let's say, you know, after our process, we craft this great, you know, overlay district and it looks really good, everything's great. How much protection is that going to afford us? I mean, I've looked at some of these zoning petitions and every single one of them from the lawyer says the UDC is unconstitutional. I mean, how much protection will this afford us?
Well, we get, it's typical in a rezoning application, we get that kind of email saying, or letter, where they're just identifying their rights. Not many of our zoning cases end up in court, only a very small percentage. I wouldn't be surprised if it's about 5%, maybe not even. It's a very small number that end up in court. But the attorneys know that if they don't fill up the file with that kind of stuff, then when they do and go into court, they don't have as solid ground as they would like to. But in reality, our zoning process and our unified development code is rarely challenged. I mean, we're one of the fastest growing counties in the entire United States. And the number of active projects we have on the ground right now, single project per line at 12-point font, it fills up 3 or 4 pages of text. We only have a couple projects in litigation right now, so I'm gonna review it from a planning standpoint, kind of a first pass. Ken Staff reviews it from a legal standpoint. He's one of the best land use attorneys in Georgia, if not the best. If he signs off on it and tells the board it's legitimate, it's going to be a sound legal document, and once it's in our ordinance as a requirement, your projects are going to comply with it. Now, what you're not going to see, all the stuff that's already developed. It's not going to come. We don't knock on their door and say, "Hey, we adopted a new rule book. Time to change your sign. Time to change your building." but it's the new stuff that comes in. We talked about this corridor. We talked about the highway project and how that probably is going to see a lot of new development. It's going to change the face of some existing developments. And anything new that comes through for permitting through Sharon's staff, whatever rules adopted, it's going to be there. I think your biggest biggest mystery in what you're going to get lies not in once it's adopted. It's in the point between this committee making the recommendation and then it going through a public process and a 5-member board of commissioners voting on it. Commissioner Boff might like everything you say top to bottom, but he's still got 4 other peers that need to agree that they like it. I think that's going to be an important part of this committee, is you're going to want to think about not just, if you just say, we don't want car dealerships, let them be someone else's problem. And if that's how it comes off the page, because our commissioners may be hesitant to say they like this overlay. And so it might be why, you also want to think about not just prohibiting uses, but if we allow certain uses, how could we change their, they have this maybe standard corporate product that they want to drop down on the ground. Are there reasonable ways we could let them still be a productive business, make some minor changes to the appearance and how it works on the ground to better suit our needs in that corridor? And if the Board of Commissioners as a whole sees it like that, they're more likely to embrace it. They think, well, this isn't just about, hey, slam the door shut here and let the problems go someplace else. It's about finding ways to work with businesses and still allow a mix of uses. But at the same time, saying that, I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't just prohibit a use either. If you think that's the right call, you got to make that call and decide and see where that goes. But that, I think, will be the biggest change as it goes through the public hearing process. I can tell you, I've drafted all kinds of ordinances in the last 15 years, and some have changed so significantly just because times change. It takes a couple months to do something, and from when I got my original direction to the time we got it back to the Board of Commissioners, priorities shifted a little, and the project shifts significantly. That happens.
I'm sorry. I was just going to ask if we'll get any political guidance then on that. Like, when we draft something with somebody saying, this is great, but it's not going to pass.
It's hard to do. It's hard to know what would pass the commission. It's a 5-member appointed board, and to try to guess how they're gonna view something is tough. Monday night I was in front of a board, on an appeal decision. And until they raised their hand and voted, I didn't have any idea which way it was gonna go, and that's typical. So I guess you could try to ask questions though. If there's something particular you are concerned about, you could ask. You could send the question in to me or another member of my staff, and we could try. The response we can try to give you maybe is, we've seen that type of thing used as a zoning condition before successfully. We've seen it in other overlays in our county successfully. Those are signs of, there's openness to the concept. And if we say, well, we've never seen that before, it's not to say it won't happen. It just, you realize you're on the cutting edge, and sometimes it's a difficult place to be.
When it's a 5-member appointed board, though, and on a big decision like that one was, when 2 are not there and it's down to just 3 to make the decision, it hurts a little bit sometimes. But a question I had, is it wrong to assume that almost all these applications are made by corporations that want to be there and want to put their business there, but they don't own the land, and their bid to buy it is only conditional based upon the zoning being approved?
It's very typical. Yeah. In particular for rezonings, they're almost always acting as you'll see a property owner. There's a lot of times it's that guy that his family's owned it for the last 50 years. And then the applicant will have the property under contract. And they're required to get owner's authorization. So we need to see that the owner has authorized them to submit this rezoning application. But I don't know the exact percentage, but easily a majority the rezoning applications are, and some agent of the applicant, not necessarily the property owner. I usually don't meet the property owners or talk to the property owners. It's the applicants and the applicant's attorneys that we see. That's who's driving the process typically.
Yes, Mr. Dineen asked about, you know, what effect is this going to have when there is a new overlay standards? Is it something that's going to be effective? And I can tell you that because there were existing overlay standards for car dealers, the Toyota and the Q Automotive did not seek variances from those standards. In other words, if you pull the chain, you get the whistle. If you want to apply to be a car dealer on that road, you have to follow these standards. So these are the kinds of things you're going to be putting together as a new package. And if the Board of Commissioners approves that, then that is the playing field they're all going to have to play on. Which is why this is important to
sure.
do it right.
We, like all communities, saw a period in 2009, 2010, where not many people were knocking on our door wanting to do anything. And I don't have any numbers on it, but my informal opinion is there was a period back then where it was easier to ask for a variance. No one else was wanting to do anything. If you were the only person wanting to do something, you said, well, to make it work, I really need a variance. My guess is if you looked at the numbers, it was easier to get them back then. Today, I think our commissioners are pretty tough on those variances, and they're really looking for a true hardship. Wanting to squeeze out that extra 10,000 square foot of floor space may not always be enough, or wanting to get those extra 10 residential lots may not be enough. Why do you really need it? What is it that you're doing? Why our standard rule book doesn't apply? So I envision that to be the case from the future. So I don't think even once it's adopted, you'll see widespread variances granted for what you get adopted. The commissioners are going to be looking at the front end and saying, is this a legitimate requirement? And once they put it in place, they're going to be hesitant to just, night after night to grant variances. And if they did that, eventually Ken and I are going to knock on their door and say, look, if you grant a variance to this every time, it makes more sense just to change it than to leave it in there and grant variances all the time. And that hasn't happened. We haven't had that discussion on any topic, so they typically stick by the book.
Generalizing, as I see it, listening to all of us, our challenge is to use your term, Alice, responsibly suggest ways to come up with a presentation for feel and for as you go through a section, but also the transition that it makes on the back end of wherever you are as it relates to butting up against a residential or O&I, that too has to be considered, both sides. And that, it's the way I'm looking. I'm listening to all of us say, okay, we just can't plunk something down here, and if it's, who's going to deem it appropriate or inappropriate? But from the perimeter of all of this, and I think what we're talking about, commercial property, is making sure it works for everybody. Is that a fair generalization of it?
That it works for everyone, yes.
Okay.
I agree. I think just going on the comments, and we don't have our whole group here. We got a majority of our group, but just going, it seems like we've got probably a little more of a homeowner slant than a business or a large lot owner, and that's something I think to keep in mind. We don't want to operate in an echo chamber,
right?
And all say, that's great, and we build this thing up, and then we present it to our elected officials and the people that own those 40 acre tracts or the people that are commercial developers or everything. They come in and pick it apart. So our elected officials, before they act on it, they're going to have to open this thing up for comments from everyone. So it's important to be thinking about that. And that's something, at a future meeting, if it's something you wanted, I think it'd be valuable, is to say, could we find a residential or a non-residential developer who'd be interested in coming in and talking to us some about where they've seen some successful models of, particularly if they're someone who operates outside our county and they do business in a lot of different areas, to come in and say, you know, where are you seeing examples of people that are doing a nice, striking that balance and finding a nice balance point between, they're getting quality and they have high standards, but not to the point that they're so high people are just avoiding the area, because you don't want that. We're going to lose either way with that. Is either that if we go too far, number one, it just might not get adopted, or number two, you know, you're going to have people just overlook the area, and long term, it's going to be challenging. Is that long term, either the codes are going to change and it's going to get thrown out. Well, I guess that'd probably be your most likely scenario then, is, you know, if we adopt something and it does happen to get through the board and no one likes it, no one's willing to develop under it, after a couple of years, the commissioners are going to say, you know what, I think you're right. You told us this was too tough, and 2 years have gone by, and we see just a bunch of, you know, dirt blowing out there, and tumbleweed. Time to reevaluate. So you want to strike the right balance. You can try to find some people, bring some people in.
Well, one of the things Commissioner Boff and I had talked about when they were talking about the Nissan dealership is, you know, while we have rights, the property owner has some right, some expectation to, you know, from appreciation in value of his own property there. And so we've got to strike a balance where ours is not diminished significantly, or his is not diminished either.
I agree, yeah. Particularly, we see
that
in residential a whole lot in this community. You know, if we, whether we allow development at 4 units per acre or one unit per acre, as long as it's consistent, a lot of the developers will tell you they don't care. We're just going to offer less for the property. You know, if you pull the carpet out from underneath us halfway through a deal, that's where we get upset. But it's the property owner that really feel the impact of that at the end of the day, because whether it's 4 units per acre or one unit per acre, you know, the developers run the numbers and just offer, they're offering a different price for the land, and that's the person who really sees, as far as their pocketbook, the biggest changes in a lot of these regulations. And that part too is because we just happen to do a lot of residential. That's the example I have on top of my head, because we do the majority of them in this county. We're building right now about almost 250 new housing units every month in this community. It's a fast pace. We're adding 5,000 to 8,000 people a year to the county. Our population right now is a little over 205,000 people. When I started here in the late 90s, it wasn't even 100,000. So, if it feels like it's changing fast, it's because it is. And for a long time, you know, every time the census releases their new information, you know, it's been a couple years where we've been the fastest growing in the entire U.S. We've almost always been in the top 10 in the last 15 years that I've been working here. So this is a unique place to be. Some people would say we're experiencing a little victim of our own success type of thing. And so many people want the proximity we have to employment, to our schools, to our parks, to Lake Lanier, to Atlanta, to the mountains, you name it. It's not an easy thing. It's not an easy thing to be a commissioner in a community like that, I can tell you.
Back in the 70s, my wife was a stockbroker, and an offer came into the office. We had a chance to buy a block of land up this direction. 400, we didn't know how far 400 was going to go. It just came into Sandy Springs, just north of 285 at that point. And we could have done it. It would have been several acres, and we would have had to change our style of living a little bit to do it, but we didn't. And part of that block of land is where the hospital is now. Would have been several acres.
No,
I think about 20 acres. that was the block.
Well, one thing I'd like to speak to is my husband and I, what we do for a living is we're residential developers. And so we develop in the county, and then we've developed in Gwinnett County, we've developed in Dawson County, we've developed a little bit everywhere. We've been doing this almost 20 years. And so I can speak on my behalf as when I'm a resident of the area where he's developing, I always give my two cents. And but we've gone through many different areas. We developed in DeKalb County, we've been everywhere. And it's always nice when there's strict regulations that everybody has to adhere to. You know, we all live in our homes and we want to enjoy our homes and enjoy our communities. And you know, the aesthetics make a big difference in that. So I think this county does a good job at that personally.
It's good to hear that. I agree with that in general. The 141 Peachtree Parkway overlay that Commissioner Boff mentioned at the start of the meeting, that was our first overlay we got adopted. And a big part of us getting adopted was Johns Creek, before the city, Johns Creek, the tech park. The guy, his name was Jim Warren, he was an architect. He managed that from a business standpoint. And he was a big proponent of quality. That's what they wanted down there. They knew that their customers weren't gonna come and spend $5 million, $10 million, whatever it was, building a big office building if next week there was going to be a used tire shop next door, or there was going to be a guy who had, you know, some business and his sign was just a piece of plywood and he took out a can of spray paint. He knew that they wanted those reassurances. It's what they had done in their park to be successful over time, with a long list of other things. He really helped the community back then, the commissioners that were on the board that time, get that adopted by coming and speaking at the public hearings and talking about that and talking about how quality is not a four-letter word necessarily, and quality is something that a lot of businesses are looking for. It has to be the right thing too. And that's, again, back to the balance of the act of you can't make it so they just can't get it done. But you don't want them to be worried about making a big investment and then being disappointed about their neighbors. I'm glad to hear that you've got some experience on each side of the equation.
Absolutely.
Anything, one thing we are going to do is we're going to work hard to keep our meetings within the time frame we identified. That's one for my staff, but also for a committee. I don't like to be on, I've been on committees before. And you make a commitment to be there till 9, and it goes to 10:30 or something, and you're like, well, I don't want to leave, but I don't want to miss my opportunity to discuss something. But we're going to try hard to respect everyone's time and wrap these things up on time at 9 o'clock. If you ever get done earlier, that's fine. We won't be offended by that. So being that we've got 5 or 6 minutes left, anything else? Are we done? We've got some things to work on. I don't know if I'm going to have it all for next week because we only have so much to fit in. But definitely we'll get on the maps and we'll get at least one of these presentations worked in for the next meeting.
For the sake of clarity, can we declare when is the next meeting? And whenever that is, I'd like to ask everybody who's here if they believe they can make that meeting.
Okay, let's see. Next meeting, June 3rd.
Yes. Anybody can't make it? No, they can't make it.
I will not be here.
I can make it.
Does anybody know Kathleen or Robyn?
Robin's out of town. I do.
Okay. Would you?
I will make sure. She,
okay.
She does. Okay. Anyone, our chairmanless committee, anyone want to make a motion that the meeting is concluded, or how we're going to adjourn?
So moved.
Is there a so moved from Steve? From Susan, we'll try to call out names here at the start. A second, anyone?
Second,
Keith. All right. Show of hands in favor of that? Unanimous.
The Naturals.
Got it down. All right, thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Think of something specific. Shoot me an email. I'll give you a call.
Okay. Yeah.
We only do go-tips.
On your part, you were...
And all we sell is this bill. Nice to meet you. I read about you. Congrats.
Robyn is great.
Because I ran across that, I ran across that before, people didn't know that.
Up till today.
Folks, there's a brochure that the planning committee, commission, and the staff has developed to explain to the citizens how the zoning process works. And I hope they'll have that for you.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Jim, where in Florida? Where in Florida are you from? Or live?
Well, I'm retired in New Orleans.
Oh.
And then we went, Jane wanted to live in Florida, so we went down there and lived in Green Cove Springs for 1 year on a golf course. It was beautiful.
Thank you.
Taxes were incredibly high. I mean, it was a mortgage payment every year to pay them. Just to pay the property tax.
Yeah.
Because it was Dade County. That doesn't mean anything. But that's what the realtors say. But,
And Florida goes up every year.
We kept coming up here for church and family, and my neighbor, who was a realtor, we had just remodeled our kitchen area and so forth, and we lived on number 8, 18-hole, the only 18-hole golf course in the county. He said, I can sell your house for, I said, no way. He said, try me. I said, I'll give you 30 days. First day he brought in two people, and it was almost a fist fight. That was the end of the boom, right at the end of the boom.
April,
the balloon
May
burst about a half a year later.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So that's earlier. So
yeah. We moved here in 11. Oh, that can't be right.
No, that can't
be right. No, no. We moved here in 04.
04.
September of 04. Okay. September of 04.
And for Dade County, you're right. It was winding down.
Yeah, well, it was still going good. I mean,
yeah, we left in 06.
We got more than we put it on the market for. We got more than we put it on the market for.
You started talking about that Highway 92.
Yeah.
I was just thinking about that about 10, 15 seconds earlier.
Between that and Cobb County.
Not just in between that and Cobb County, it goes all the way to Woodstock and that white fence along that way, like they're talking about that industrial fence, that white fence. Yes, sir. But what's interesting is that road runs through three counties, at least two municipalities, and somehow they agreed to do all of that. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's three counties that thing runs through like that.
So I'll get a bus and tour that together with the commission.
Susan, good meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And one other issue is
It's good seeing you again. Take care. Bye-bye. Get out of there.
Okay. The lady on the right said it right. Let's just make it.
All right.
Kurt, thanks for inviting me.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for serving on the committee. Yeah, good night. Thank you. Bye-bye, Stephen.
Bye.